The PLC team you will see in this video is composed of middle school teachers who will be collaboratively analyzing the data from a common formative assessment. This assessment was given to their students during a unit of study. Not all of their formative assessments are common, and many will not be recorded. However, it's important that at some point during the unit, teachers record student assessment data in connection with the student learning objectives. This template is one way of capturing the data and the SLOs. It can be done electronically using a number of tools, including an Excel spreadsheet or Google Sheets. When a team of teachers comes together to collaboratively analyze formative assessment data, they are able to make powerful instructional decisions in the middle of the unit to specifically target the learning needs of students. This is where true differentiated instruction and effective timely interventions across a grade level take place. Let's see how this is accomplished.
Hi, welcome to our professional learning community meeting. Thank you for attending. Before we begin our meeting, let's go over our norms. These are the norms that we developed together at the beginning of the year and that help guide us along the way as we're developing, delivering, and today reflecting on and revising curriculum and assessments.
Honor start and end times, state the objective and stay focused, actively listen and participate, voice and respond to concerns positively and non-judgmentally, address violations of the norms, slow down to think, reflect, and puzzle about things.
Okay, thank you very much, Christine. And while these norms have been great in guiding our work throughout the year, today specifically, we're going to be looking at formative assessment data. So we are going to use the guidelines for collaborative analysis of assessment data. Now, remember in the beginning of the year, when we first had to bring data to these meetings, it was very intimidating, it was a little scary.
Right. Yeah.
But throughout the year, we've gotten much better at it, much more comfortable. And using these guidelines, we can help all of our students grow and achieve in different areas. Sherry, would you mind reading those guidelines?
Sure. Be honest about what the data is saying about your current reality. No blaming. Focus on what the data says about the progress of each student. Recognize that it is not about you, it is about what you can do next to improve each student's level of success. The data is not a reflection of your teaching, it is a reflection of student learning. What you do with the data is a reflection of your professionalism. Reflect on how unit activities or student strategies can be revised. Share best practices as well as things that may not have worked as planned. Review the assessment to ensure it effectively measures the student learning objectives. And finally, if there's a formative assessment, use the data to plan next instructional steps, including flexible grouping, differentiation, and intervention.
Okay. Are there any questions about the guidelines before we get started? In the past, we've taken turns leading the discussion. Today, we're going to be viewing data from my students' class. So would anyone like to start us off today?
Well, I think we should make note that the rubric is based out of 4 points.
Okay.
And being that we're going to be highlighting with 3 colors, we should really break up the different categories.
Okay. Green would be for 4s and 3s. Yellow will be for 2s, and pink will be for 1s.
Okay.
So did anyone notice any patterns or anything that kind of jumped out to you as you were doing the tallying?
So one of the first things that I noticed is we still have a lot of students that are developing and emerging under the development of ideas, use of evidence category.
Right.
It seems to be almost a balance as far as scores are concerned for the advanced and proficient under both categories. And it seems to go the same way when you have the emerging students.
Yeah, this is really a great visual to really see connections.
So what kind of activities or interventions do you think would help their development of ideas or their use of evidence when doing a language arts assignment?
I think we can definitely focus on having the students do activities such as locating evidence by highlighting or adding pieces of evidence from a text into a graphic organizer so it's more concrete and a visual aid for them.
Great. And what about for the organization of their writing?
So we can definitely do some activities that focus on these tasks as an individual task. So breaking up the key components, what makes a strong introduction, and just practicing that skill, incorporating it into homework assignments, almost making it like mini lessons throughout the week.
Okay, great.
Seems like we have about half the students emerging or developing and the other half advanced or proficient.
Right.
While we're trying to build up the emerging and developing students, are we going to lose the focus of the advanced and proficient students by repeating these activities?
Most likely. So we'll definitely have to, you know, include some differentiation, maybe give them some activities that can really enhance the skills that they already have. Maybe we can even pair some of the stronger students up with the students who are in emerging and see what they can do to, you know, pull from each other.
Yeah, I really like the idea of flexible groupings to help with that.
So perhaps you don't have to just stick to your students. You can gather maybe the advanced and proficient students you can work with from all classes.
So we can have flexible groupings within our own classrooms, and we can also do flexible groupings as a department. And that's a wonderful idea.
What if certain students, after receiving professional resources, after receiving some sort of PD, after the flexible grouping, some students are still not performing? Because again, we're looking for the students to progress from pre-assessment to the SLOs leading up to the summative assessment.
I mean, at that point, I would probably have a conference with a student one-on-one, try to figure out, you know, what exactly their strengths, weaknesses, fears are with the subject matter, and try to develop a plan together with that student to figure out what exactly is going on and what we can do to help them master the skills.
All right, we've done a great job of analyzing data from the students in my class, but part of a professional learning community is to compare strategies that we use from one person's class to the other person's class. Okay, so let's take a quick look at Sherry's data.
Immediately, I see that most of the students fall into the developing. But we can look at it several different ways. We talked about revisiting the rubric, so that's one thing.
One strategy that I use for my class is modeling. So when I was going over this skill, I was looking at the novel Anne Frank. And as we were reading our novel, I helped model for the students how to pull the evidence out of those texts. Okay, so it seemed like, Sherry, some of your students, as compared to my class, were still in the developing and emerging stages for organization.
Right.
Did you use a graphic organizer?
I did not.
I actually, I found this great graphic organizer that I used with my class to help them with the organization of their ideas. So you can take a quick look at that.
I like this.
Yeah, this looks great. Yes.
Perhaps that we should implement this into the unit.
All right, so if you don't mind, since you're the only one that used the graphic organizer, if we take a look at my data, see if it's comparable to Sherry's. And just scanning this real quick, I do notice that, like Sherry's, a lot of my students are falling into the developing range as well.
If that graphic organizer made a big difference, maybe we should implement that into our curriculum as well.
Okay.
So I'll go ahead after the meeting and put that on the Google site.
That'll be very helpful.
Yes.
For, I guess, the anecdotal data, I would also put some sort of reflective writing for the students to respond where they felt they went wrong and why.
Okay.
And I think that's valuable for the students' perception of the expectation.
Absolutely. That would also be a great conversation starter if it gets down to that one-on-one conversation.
That's true in the conference. Yeah.
Absolutely. So thank you again, Christine. Thank you again, Sherry. And thank you, Dr. Felice. And I hope everyone gained something very valuable. And we'll continue to work on this as we have from the beginning of the year.
In the early part of a CAR process, PLC teams unpack the standards and create a clear, student-friendly learning objectives. As you can see here, these SLOs have now been used to assess students' progress. In this way, teachers are able to make effective instructional decisions that will target the specific needs of students and improve their learning. When teachers analyze formative assessment data collaboratively, they are able to tap into each other's strengths. As they share resources, strategies, and ideas, they are doing this in relation to the SLOs of the unit and the specific needs of the students. This is how student learning is improved. The collaborative nature of this work also reduces the workload on individual teachers. For example, if several students across the grade level are in need of reteaching, One teacher can focus on developing the resources for this group, while our colleagues develop and share resources for other groups of students. Ultimately, the goal of a PLC is to strengthen teacher practice and improve student learning. Teachers coming together to analyze and respond to formative assessment data do just that.